So this afternoon, after Eric, John Swinton is going to lead us off, and then we're going to have a panel with some other people from here at Atlanta. We're learning a lot about the gifts of people in Atlanta between the panel folks and the workshop leaders, and are very grateful for that. We're also going to try something during this presentation, and Rudy Reagan is going to be voicing the slides quickly, that she and John have worked that out. So without further ado, let me introduce my Scottish friend and very well-known pastoral theologian. Some of you may not know, he was a psychiatric nurse for 17 years before deciding to go to seminary. Says there might be a lot of healthcare workers out there who'd like to do the same thing, and human service workers, but John is one of the most articulate people, I think, writing in the area of pastoral theology these days related to disability, dementia, and so many other kinds of aspects, and he doesn't need any more introduction. John Swinton.
Well, good afternoon. That's not very friendly. So, good afternoon. I know, it's like being at school, isn't it? Like, good afternoon, Mr. Swinton. Anyway, it's a pleasure to be here this afternoon to be able to share a few things with you in relation to hospitality. But I want to take you into the area of hospitality in a slightly different way. We're going to take a little journey, and that journey is going to take us through reflection on our bodies, reflection on our souls, and reflection on our hearts. And when we come round to the end of that process, I want us to begin to think about what belonging looks like, what hospitality looks like, but also what diversity looks like. And the place I want to begin is with this little passage from 1 Corinthians. You could say, in some senses, what I'm going to talk to you about is an extended meditation on this. Paul says, "Don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you?" Now, there's a great beauty in noticing what's going on there. We become who we are, not as individuals, but as a body, as people who come together in our diversity, in our differentness. And indeed, it's only in our diversity and our differentness that we can become who we are. You know, it's a very countercultural thing. We assume we can be who we are because we know certain things, or because we do certain things, or because we have a certain history. Paul says, no, we become who we are as we engage with the body of Christ. And there's something wonderful about that as an image, that no matter what shape or form you are, no matter what your thoughts are like, no matter what your social position is, you are exactly the same in your diversity in the midst of the body. We live in what... go ahead.
It's a person, and inside their brain, there's an image of somebody sitting in a chair watching, I think, something that looks like a television.
There's somebody looking out from the top of their head. And we live in a hypercognitive culture. Stephen Post describes hypercognition as an unnecessary and unhealthy focus on cognitive and intellect above other important aspects of being human. And so we think that thinking is more significant than being. We think that thinking is more significant than relationships, love, community. As soon as you meet someone, you'll ask them a question and they will give you an answer based on their story. You ask them what they do, who they are, they'll tell you what they do. We all do it. And when people tell us what we do, then we place them in a particular social hierarchy. I want to suggest that that's just the wrong way to understand what it means to be a human being. Minds are important, but bodies are profoundly important. And I want us now to think a little bit about our bodies.
It's a person who seems to be throwing something.
Right. It's a person with cerebral palsy in a very beautiful position, dancing, moving in particular rhythmic ways to express deep thoughts and deep emotions. We come to know the world through our bodies. Now look around this room. Each one of us is a different shape, is a different form, is a different, inhabits a different space. All of our bodies tell us different things about the world. We think that we think our way into knowing things, but in fact, we embody things. We come to know the world through our bodies. John Hull, a British practical theologian, in a wonderful book called Touching the Rock, describes his experience of losing his sight and the way in which everything begins to shift and change, and his body becomes one of the main sensory organs for making sense of the world. And so for Hull, sound is different. For most of us, when we hear sound, we move our bodies in that particular direction, and we hear it and we process it in the context of what we see. For Hull, sound changed. Sound comes, sound goes. So he had to reconceive his understanding of what sound was. Colours had to be described. The world had to be touched and felt in that way. And what he points towards is that because he was forced to encounter the world with his body, he suddenly discovered that actually his body told him new things about the world, things that he couldn't see. He talked about the idea that sighted people think that the only way that you can encounter the world is by looking at it. But Hull says, no, that's all right if you are a sighted person who wants to look at it that way. He discovered that actually he encountered the world in radically different ways. All of us encounter the world through our bodies, he says. The body is a source of knowledge. None of us encounter the world in the same way, and that's really important. There is no point of normality because each one of us encounters the world through our bodies in particular ways. And there's no point in which we can call our experience of the world normal. Each experience of the world, Hull says, is a perspective, is a way of looking at the world. And it's only when these multiple perspectives of what it means to be a human being come together in conversation, in hospitable conversations, that we can actually understand what it means to be a human being. So what he's saying is, to be a human being is a broad range of possibilities within which there are multiple bodies. So you manifest humanness in one way, I manifest it differently, but it's only when we come together that we can begin to work out what it means to be a human being. In other words, humanness is something that we do together. It's not something that's simply to do with biology, shape, form, ability, inability. It's something that we do together as our different bodies construct our understandings of the world. In Aberdeen, we used to have a very interesting pastoral care course. Within that pastoral care course, it was delivered from a distance, or at a distance, which means that in the room, me as a lecturer or anybody else, you had students online, you had students on the telephone, you had students, so it was pretty chaotic, really, trying to hold that whole thing together. But on this occasion, we had somebody in the room who had absolutely no sight, and somebody who had a profound hearing impairment. And the person with a profound hearing impairment had her dog with her, a hearing dog, which told her which barked when the phone rang or when the doorbell rang. And it was really interesting. And at one point, she also had a signer with her. At one point, we're talking about spiritual experiences. And we went around the room and everybody was sharing their spiritual experiences. And it came to the turn of this young lady with the hearing dog. And through her interpreter, she said, she tells us a story about how she met Jesus. And she said, Jesus was a wonderful thing. It was everything that I had hoped Jesus would be. And then she said, and his signing was amazing. In other words, her vision of who God was and her vision of what heaven would look like involved using her body in a particular way. It didn't involve reclaiming or being given new ways of encountering the world at her hearing back. It was for the world, and ultimately for Jesus, to take the shape and the form of the way that she's always communicated. So bodies matter because bodies communicate, and bodies matter because bodies are the way in which we experience and understand the world. If we take that seriously, think about it this way. If you have a visual impairment, you may never see the scriptures. If you have a hearing impairment, you may never hear the word. If you have no arms, you may never feel what it's like to embrace someone, even though you are embraced. To be embraced by the love of God will have a totally different meaning. Not a better meaning or a worse meaning, but just a different meaning. Likewise, if you can see clearly, you'll never know what it's like to encounter God without sight. If you can hear well, you will never know what it's like to sign the word of God and to use your body to communicate the meaning of God's love in ways which a hearing person simply cannot grasp. If you can remember everything well, you'll never know what it is like to encounter God without remembering God. It's only in the diversity that we come to know the broadness and the beauty and the wonder of the world and ultimately of ourselves and God.
This is clouds?
It's people.
It's people.
Yeah, it's people locked together in a kind of embrace that indicates a close connection between all of us. And I want to move on to think about that. So bodies are significant. Diversity of bodies is significant. But what are our bodies? What are they made of? What do they mean in that sense? And to answer that, I want to go to the Genesis account of creation. Genesis account of creation is a beautiful picture of God creating the world out of nothing. Like, he creates the world, and then ultimately at the peak of creation, he begins to create human beings. And the Lord God formed man of the dust and the ground and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul. God takes that which is inanimate, blows his spirit into it, and it becomes animate. In other words, the Spirit of God is that which animates all human beings. There's a deep connection between God and human beings at that level. Our bodies are the place where God inspires us in profound and deep ways. St. Augustine describes human beings as terra animata, animated earth, which is, you know, we're made from that, which is why we have so much in common with creation in that sense, because we are at that depth, part of that creation, coming from it, inspired by God. The human beings are thus seen to be created from matter, but inspired, given breath, brought into living existence by the very breath of God. This is the important point. We are our bodies as we are our souls. There's something of the divine that inspires everybody. You can see it in the beginning of John's gospel when John says the light of God is within all human beings. There's something deep, something mature, something wonderful in human beings that each one of us are held and inspired by God. So as earth animated by the breath of God, human beings are seen to be, as Wendell Berry puts it, holy creatures living amongst other holy creatures in a world that is holy. Now, can you imagine what it would be like if we actually looked at one another in that way? Looked at one another as holy creatures living amongst other holy creatures in a world that is holy. Everything changes. Our relationship changes. Our understanding of disability changes. Our politics changes. Our ecclesiologies, everything changes when we begin to see the holiness. And that's not to say that human beings are in and of themselves holy, because the holiness comes from God. But it is to say that God resides in a powerful way, in a sustaining way within human beings. And in that sense, every body is holy. So attending to God's creatures is in fact a mode of attending to God. And that doesn't mean to say that we kind of peep round other people trying to see God. It means as we care for one another, so we care for God. And so we attend to one another's needs, so we are, in a meaningful sense, attending to God.
Two hands holding two rocks. On one of the rocks is written the word body, and on the other rock is written the word soul.
We are our bodies as we are our souls. And that's really important. I'm giving you an image here of soulfulness and ensouledness that encompasses all that we are. Not that your soul is something that's apart from your body, but in the wholeness of your body, we encounter the soul. We encounter the breath of God.
Person and a baby, and the baby is covering the person's face.
That's right. It's a picture of love for the baby embracing the head of a young girl there. Could be her mother, could be someone else. But Joseph Pieper describes love in this way. He says, "It's good that you are here, and I'm glad that you exist." In other words, love is embodied. When we look at one another, we see one another through the eyes of love. It's good that you are here, and I'm glad that you exist. Try saying that to the person beside you. It's good that you're here. I'm glad that you exist. As soon as you say these words, you begin to form community. As soon as you say these words, the body of the person before you becomes lovable, becomes beautiful. It can be nothing else. So there's a great power in recognizing our bodies properly, and there's a great space that's created for loving one another faithfully. Now,
baby with a somewhat surprised and or distressed face, and captioned, "So what?"
That's exactly right. A baby with a surprised and distressed face. Because, you know, it's nice, it's sweet, these things, but there is a so what question. Okay, so you've developed a body theology, but so what? Well, I would say there's a big so what. And let me give you an illustration of why it's important to take bodies seriously. This is Baroness Mary Warnock, who is an English ethicist, never well-known moralist and an ethicist. In an article in the Church of Scotland, which I'm a Presbyterian, which is the only true denomination, but we'll talk about that later. When it comes to the altar call, you'll understand. In the Presbyterian Church of Scotland magazine, she was engaging in an interview about various things, not about dementia, which is where she came from, but suddenly she began to talk about dementia. And this is what she said about dementia. She said, "If you're demented, you're wasting people's lives, your family's lives, and you're wasting the resources of the National Health Service." Wait, the way that she ran with that is, because if you have dementia, if you cannot think anymore, if you cannot remember your history, you cease to be a person. If you cease to be a person, then you cease to have the rights to participate in these kind of social services. But then she goes on, putting it rather brutally, she said, "You'd be licensing people to put others down. Actually, I think, why not? Because the real person is gone already, and all that's left to follow that on is a shell," she says. That's a classic example of somebody who doesn't understand the significance of the body. The idea that somehow when this small part of your body goes, then the whole of you disappears in terms of morals and ethics is just a mistake. You know, so it's something like 95% of what human beings do is done at the cognitive level. But we prioritize that cognitive level as if it's everything. So it matters the way that we think about bodies, and it matters the way in which we develop our understandings of human beings as embodied, not simply as embrained. And you can see that way of thinking throughout the euthanasia debate in this sense, but also throughout the way that we treat people with profound intellectual disabilities, people with brain injuries, people with dementia. It's all this idea that somehow something is changing your thinking, either it hasn't developed or it's changed, so therefore you cease to be. Within that kind of perspective I'm giving to you, this makes no sense whatsoever. What Warnock is putting here is the exact opposite of it's good that you exist, I'm glad that you are here. The exact opposite of love. But many people within our society think that's all right. Martin Buber, in his book Good and Evil, draws out a very interesting distinction between good and evil, love and evil. He says, in order to love something or someone, you've got to do something. You've got to reach out, you've got to grasp them, you've got to do something physically and psychologically. But in order to do evil, you just don't have to think about it. So you have to move into love, but you slide into evil. And it's very easy when we think about the way all of our societies are run sometimes, we don't notice things that when they're brought to our attention are very, very obvious. Let me show you why I think it's important to notice bodies and why I think Warnock's made a mistake. For many years, I worked alongside people with dementia. And the beauty of...
An elderly woman praying.
That's absolutely right. The beauty of working with people with dementia is that you suddenly realize things you could never see before. If you take the practice of giving the sacraments, if any of you have ever worked with people with dementia, you'll go into a space where they live, and for many people, that will be a space where they are withdrawn or sad or kind of not engaged. You begin to give the sacrament or say a prayer or sing a song, and everything changes. Suddenly, they're back into the place where they've always been. They'll pray, they'll participate in the sacrament, they'll say the words of the sacraments, they'll sing along with the songs and all of these different things. Now, at one level, if you want to take a purely neurological perspective, you might say, well, that's just well-ingrained memory. But it's much more than that. It's much more than that. When we think about memory, we tend to think about recall memory. Something happened in the past, we bring it into the present, and we project our understandings of what we should do and how we respond onto the future. And of course, for many people with dementia, they begin to lose that recall memory. And so we say, well, they've lost their memory. But of course, that's not strictly true, because your body remembers things. As over time you engage in the rituals and the practices of your spiritual tradition, your body remembers them. Your body remembers the shape and the form of the rituals. Your body remembers the words. Your body remembers the atmosphere and all of the things that go along with participating in that or any other stimulating event. So the idea that somehow the only kind of memory we have is recall memory is a mistake. Because our bodies are here, our bodies remember things. And more than that, memory is processed in lots of different places in your brain, but some of the major memory processing aspects of your brain are quite close to the aspects of your brain that enable you to appreciate music. And so sometimes with dementia, the problem is not so much that you forget something, it's that the neurological connection between the memory and your ability to recall it is broken, so you can't access it. And music can be a way of bridging that broken neurological synaptic gap. And so it can be that music, and certainly also certain rituals and practices, are the only way that you can access that. No other way to do that, just a particular way of accessing the memory. And of course, when you hear music, you don't just hear it. It's full of emotion. It's full of history. It's full of experiences. And so when you see somebody singing in that situation, they're not just kind of humming along. They're taken back to a place in their history, a place in time, a place where things happened, a place that's filled with emotion. Their bodies are full of memories. We may focus in on one, but actually, if we shift our gaze a little bit, things change. Trust in the power of the soul is one way we could put that. And when we begin to see and think about how significant our bodies are...
I didn't quite make this one up. They're outdoors in front of a stone wall, and it's Are there two people in the picture?
Yep, the picture is of, this is Elizabeth, rather, who I'm going to be speaking to. She's with one of her friends, who is actually one of her carers, and they're feeding goats.
They're feeding goats,
that's right. So when we begin to think in these ways, a lot of really interesting things begin to happen. A few years ago, we did a research project which was exploring the spiritual needs of people with profound and complex intellectual disabilities. People who didn't have words as their first port of language or call of language or use of language. And we spent time with families and we spent time with individuals, and it was a fascinating experience at a number of different levels. But Elizabeth's story, I think, will help to illustrate something of what I'm trying to get us all to think about. Elizabeth was a young lady who had significant cerebral palsy. She had a profound intellectual disability, and she was she had no sight whatsoever. She was a Quaker. She was a member of the Quaker community, and with the Quaker community, everybody is initiated early into their lives, into the community. So from the moment that they're born to the moment that they die, they're part of this community. Now, in the midst of all of Elizabeth's difficulties, something else happened, and I'm going to tell you two stories and put them together. She was diagnosed with leukemia. And she had to go to hospital, and she had to be go through various tests and what have you. And eventually they discovered it was leukemia, and Elizabeth was lying in her bed, and her mum came in and said, Elizabeth, you've got leukemia. Now, immediately, Elizabeth became distressed, anxious, and began to cry. Now, I would be very surprised if Elizabeth had the language to enable to know what leukemia was, but something happened. Second story. As I say, Elizabeth is a Quaker, and at the heart of the Quaker worship is silence. So they have this beautiful, deep, spiritual silence, which is the place where they dwell and their understanding of what God is or what the higher power may be. And one of the things that the Quaker community that we visited pointed out was how affected Elizabeth was by the Quaker worship. And they said, well, let us show you. So the Quakers gathered around. So they formed a circle with Elizabeth was in the center of that circle, or towards the far left. And they began to engage with their practices of worship. Right? So they went into this deep, deep silence. Now, initially, Elizabeth was quite noisy, a little bit anxious, a little bit distressed. And she was quite noisy. And then the community went into this silence. And you could just watch Elizabeth because she just sank into the silence. She became quiet. She became peaceful. And eventually, it was almost like she was engulfed by the silence of the spiritual practice of this particular community. So how are we going to understand these two stories? Well, story number one, Mum tells Elizabeth that she has leukemia. Now, who knows? But Elizabeth probably wasn't able to understand that. But she was able to understand her mother's bodily gestures. She could understand her anxiety, her concern, her stiffness, all of these things, and that communicated to her. You know, I don't know if you've ever been in the presence of somebody who's very, very anxious. Eventually, you'll become very, very anxious yourself. Yeah, and this, I suspect, but don't know, this is how it ran with Elizabeth. In the Quaker meeting, something similar happened. When the Quakers went into their deep silence, it communicated. It created a space, their bodies, and their postures created a space, the lack of noise created a space within which Elizabeth participated. She was drawn into the silence of the worshiping community and became a part of it. Now, the important thing to think about there is postmodern spirituality tends to be a mode of self-actualization. I want a sense of meaning and purpose and hope and value. What we see in that little Quaker community is the fact, and it's an obvious fact, really, spirituality is something that we do together. It's always something that we do together with our bodies, with our minds, with our brothers and sisters. And for Elizabeth, that was the place where she found community. And that was also the place where her spirituality was drawn into communication and relationship with the spirituality of others. So becoming human is something that we do together. Our bodies do it together. Our understanding comes as we understand one another. And even within our deepest spiritual practices, we do it together. I'll explain this if that's okay. This is a picture of Jean Vanier, who will be familiar to many of you, the founder of the L'Arche communities, who are communities for people with profound intellectual disabilities, or for people with intellectual disabilities, within which people live together, not as carer and cared for, but as friends in the spirit of the Beatitudes and in the friendships of Jesus. At the heart of Jean Vanier's thinking is the heart. There's something very profound about that. Mary Warnock would have no understanding of what the heart was, but Vanier says the heart is what a person is. The person is the heart. And here we have a picture of an elderly woman in a relaxed position, just resting on her heart, her hands, and the idea being that she has peacefulness in her heart. Vanier says, the heart is the deepest, most fundamental aspect of the human being that's touched and transformed by the spirit. Behind all the barriers, Vanier says, built up since childhood, there is the pure and innocent heart of a child where the gift of God resides. The heart is capable of receiving and giving love, of living in communion with another person and with God, capable of being a source of life for others. In the designs of God, it's the heart which is meant to inspire all human activities. So Vanier says, your body's important, because L'Arche is a place of bodies. L'Arche is the name of the communities that Jean Vanier formed. It's a place where bodies matters, where the day-to-day practices of caring for one another matters, and they matter because they're aspects of the heart. So we care for the heart in the everydayness of our practices, Vanier says. So as you look after one another, as we wash one another, as we talk to one another, so we reach into that deep place within which our true person resides, that place of affectivity, that place of relationship. So all relationships, all coming together of bodies, is heart to heart and soul to soul. I think that's just such an important way to think. All human relationships should be heart to heart and soul to soul. Our bodies matter, our hearts matter, our souls matter. And that takes us back to the passage I began with. Paul says, don't you realize that all of you together are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God lives in you? The Spirit of God resides in your body, in your heart, in your mind, in your soul. And it's only when we can learn to see, and it's a matter of shifting our glance and looking properly, only when we can learn to see one another properly in the light of that body, mind, heart, and soul, that the possibility of community becomes a reality. Because communities are places where people belong. It's not simply a place where people are included. Hans and I had this conversation this morning. To include somebody, you just need to open up a space and have them in the room. To belong, you need to look at them properly. And what I've been trying to give you is a new way of looking at one another. There's still political dimensions, there's still social dimensions, but giving ourselves a new way of envisaging our bodies begins to open up new space for communities of belonging. Now, that doesn't exclude, as Hans made very clear this morning, the need for lament, because sometimes we don't like our bodies, sometimes our bodies are uncomfortable, sometimes our bodies are difficult. But no matter what they are, they're still valuable, they're still beautiful, and they're still heart and soul inspired in that sense. So if we can begin to look at one another slightly differently and begin to see that vision of ensouled living, then we can change things. And things can be done different. And it's not ridiculous. It's simply making small changes to the gestures that we use to make sense of the world. And these small changes ultimately will be transformative. Thank you for listening. And thank you for describing.